there's several pieces that need to come together to create a good strategic operational planner. I think a critical piece is understanding the planning process and where objectives come from, how they tear down from the strategic level land management plans to the fire management plan to the incident, and how all of those objectives are connected at different levels and how to apply that to the fire. That's a critical piece, and that's even more critical when it's brought out in WFDSS. WFDSS was partially meant to support that process of ensuring that our land management objectives are applied when we make decisions on fire management. Another critical skill is understanding that risk assessment process and being able to apply that to the situation in any fire incident. Being able to look at what are the probabilities that a fire is going to reach this area, what kind of fire would meet our objectives, what kind of fire would not meet our objectives in that particular point at the landscape, and being able to look at an FS Pro run and understand what that output means, evaluate whether it's a valid run or needs more work, being able to look at the values that we're trying to protect, keeping in mind what the cost would be to protect that value, and blending that into the risk assessment to ensure that we're spending commensurate with the values that we're protecting. That's a critical piece. Another critical piece is being able to work with the technical specialists. You know, SOPL doesn't have to be capable of running fire behavior programs themselves, but they need to be able to communicate with the fire behavior analysts, communicate what is the management question we're trying to answer with this fire behavior run. And then when the fire behavior analyst provides that output, they have to be able to interpret it and communicate that to the decision makers, particularly the agency administrator, who may not have in-depth experience in looking at fire behavior outputs. So the SOPL is acting as a conduit between the technical specialists in fire behavior and the decision makers in interpreting their outputs. Another important skill for the SOPL is the ability to look forward and think days and weeks ahead of time. And it takes some of the pressure off the regular operations chief and planning operations, because they're concentrating on today and tomorrow. Yeah. And that SOPL is looking out beyond that. On our incident management team, when we do our evening plan strategy meeting, we go to operations chief, and that person talks about what happened today. We go to planning ops, that person talks about what's going to happen tomorrow. Then we go to our SOPL and say, what's going to happen 2 to 4 days out? And they tell us about the weather, the fire behavior, if we're going to reach any of those management action points as the fire spreads in those days, so that the operations people can then plan on that farther out, because we've already made a tentative plan for the MAPs or management action points, and that's what the SOPL brings into the planning part of the IMT, is that outlook for 2 to 4 days down and maybe even beyond that. And then that input is taken into account when we look at each member of the team and ask them if they can support the plan. It becomes a part of the input to determine whether we can support the plan, in that we need to make sure that tomorrow's plan fits into the long-range view of what the fire is going to do and how we're going to respond to it. They need a basic understanding of the thought process in WFDSS, and they are intimately involved in developing that course of action that goes in WFDSS. So they do need to understand how the course of action fits into WFDSS, what the other elements are, and they are often looked to as the WFDSS person, because there's a natural marriage between the SOPL position and any decision support. The SOPL is coming up with recommendations and support for the agency administrator's decision. And so a basic familiarity with that thought process of WFDSS, particularly the course of action, is critical for the SOPL. We're trying to avoid the SOPL position becoming the WFDSS tech, however. That person is responsible for the thought process of developing the WFDSS decision, but is not necessarily the technical person on the management organization that would be entering all the information into WFDSS. There's various roles in WFDSS and they have different responsibilities. So the SOPL is not the WFDSS technical person who knows the ins and outs of how to load images into WFDSS and create the entire decision document. They interact with a significant piece of the WFDSS process. And because the SOPL position evolved from the fire use manager position, who was responsible for the wildland fire implementation plan that bears a very close resemblance to many pieces of the WFDSS document, those individuals who were skilled as fire use managers are going to apply those same skills as a SOPL to develop a course of action for WFDSS. And that is what we're trying to preserve, is that ability to come up with a complex course of action for a long-term fire. It's just that it's been expanded from just those fires that were used for resource benefit that were called fire use. That process is being, that thought process of looking at a fire over the long run and developing recommendations for actions based on the fire's behavior and movement is now applied to all fires in WFDSS. So it is, that individual has a natural relationship with WFDSS. I think it's important that we learn how to incorporate the SOPL into a wider variety of fires than we had used the fire use managers for in the past. Although this position came from the fire use manager position, it's now used on a fire regardless of the incident strategy, whether it's protection objectives or resource benefit objectives. There may be cases where even when we want to put a direct perimeter around the entire incident as quickly as possible, that may be our desire, but it may not be possible. There's a variety of reasons. For instance, you know, one of the overriding objectives on every incident is firefighter and public safety. So if this fire can't be put out safely, having the objective of putting it out isn't going to be a reasonable objective. There may be cost constraints where our strategy of using full suppression isn't going to be commensurate with the cost of the values that we're protecting. Another case may be where in a busy fire season, we all know that we can't always get all the resources we want. So we may want to put the fire out, we may want to apply lots of resources, but they just aren't available. And even when that fire may be the highest priority of the nation and seems to have unlimited resources, like in Yellowstone in 1988, no amount of resources was going to be able to put that fire out under the extreme conditions that were being experienced in Yellowstone in 1988. So what a SOPL would bring to those situations is, if we can't put it out in spite of our desire to put it out, what are our other options? How else can we look at this? What can we bring to the table to at least support our objectives to the greatest extent possible in those situations where we can't put the fire out, even if that's what our desired objective would be? And so what a SOPL can bring then is looking at the fire behavior as it spreads across the landscape over time and tease out those opportunities and those actions that have a higher probability of success, and bring that to the table as options, and then we can use those options to meet our objectives to the greatest extent possible on the fire incident, whether those are protection objectives or objectives for resource benefit. I like to think of the strategic operational planner as the champion of the host unit's objectives. They're the ones that are keeping those objectives in the forefront of their mind as they're going into a fire and looking at what the opportunities are. One of the great things about the 2009 guidance, as you said, is it gives the fire managers greater latitude in applying different objectives across the landscape for the same fire, but that inherently is going to make the fire management situation more complex. And what a SOPL can do is be looking at those objectives and looking for opportunities to meet those objectives across the landscape. As you said, there may be opportunities in some parts of the fire to gain resource benefit, where other parts of the fire may have sensitive natural and cultural resources, human infrastructure, or commercial values that need to be protected. And that SOPL can keep those objectives in the forefront of the picture for managing that fire and apply those objectives across the landscape as the fire moves over time and space and encounters different situations.